So I was trying to figure out this week how I could sort of blend the story of Scripture with my own story of returning home, and I couldn't figure it out because I don't know whether you realize this, but I was not exiled. And I wasn't sent away as punishment either. But I wanted to tell you this about my sabbatical just very briefly, because I think it does tie into the message of the day today. A year ago April, I was praying with the pastors at a three-day prayer summit up on Mount Lemmon, and I was praying about what God would want for my sabbatical this year. And you know how sometimes God gives you an answer, but it really lacks specificity? So God just laid one huge word on my heart, and that was serve. I want you on this sabbatical to serve. And so I began to think about that and pray about that. And last August, when the hurricanes hit the Houston area, having lived in a little city, Dickinson, just south of Houston, for my internship, it was immediately clear to me that God wanted me to go serve in hurricane relief in Houston. And so the first thing I did in October, when we met with the LCMC gathering at our annual gathering, I went and talked to the folks from Houston about helping, and they went, They had no specific ideas for what might be coming in June. That was, of course, last October. And I thought, okay, well, let me give them a little more time to get their act together. I knew that the council wanted a plan from me in January. So I gave them a little more time. I called them in November. Called them in December. Called them kind of desperate in January because I knew the council wanted a plan from me. And they said, we don't have any idea. And I went, great. So I called Lutheran congregation, I called the North American Lutheran Church, our sort of sister synod in the denominational alphabet of churches, Lutheran churches. And they go, oh, yeah, well, we got some stuff happening. I go, well, what's that? They go, well, we don't really know. And I went through the entire spring putting the council off with a plan because I couldn't get no specifics out of Houston for how I could come and serve in the month of June. And I finally, honestly, I gave up. I thought, well, that must have been a misperception on my part. Maybe that's not what God had in mind for me after all. So I called our friends in Haiti, and I said, how about if I come to Haiti for the month of June to serve? I figured, you know, we've done these food packing things. We've sent mission teams that have been there. I'm going, easy in. That's a great place to serve. Great need. And you know what they said? We don't want you. No, I mean, I was shocked. They didn't want me. I'm going, wow. And so council said, you know, we have to have a plan. You're months late already. And so I added some academic work saying, well, I'm going to go to Houston and we'll kind of see what happens when we get there. I want you to know I went to Houston because I felt God call me to Houston all the way a year ago. And by the second day in Houston, they had opportunities to serve planned for me for every day for the next 2 weeks. And by the end of that week, I literally had opportunities to serve throughout Redmond, Richmond, and the other place I was, where I was actually staying. Why am I blanking? Anyway, Rosenberg and Richmond. And God just totally provided and opened up the door. And one of the provisions, this is interesting, Marilyn and I pull in. She rode out there with me to help me with the drive. And we pull in and we meet the coordinator who's putting me up in this parsonage. And the first thing he says is, well, we came this morning to kind of get things ready and the air conditioner was broken. He says, we got it fixed, but the house is still too hot. We're going to put you up in a hotel. So he puts us up in this really nice hotel. The next morning we meet, he takes us on a tour. he hands me, I think, 3 or 4 different restaurant gift cards so that I can eat while I'm there. And he hands me $150 worth of gift cards that are provided for them for people who come and volunteer to Walmart. I had no expectations of that level of provision. And then not only that, the people of Texas essentially fed me every day at least one meal while I was serving with him. God provides when he calls us to do his work, but the provision doesn't always come in our timing. But we can trust that he will provide. Let's get a listen to the video to set us up for this morning's lesson.
Before the Israelites left Babylon, the king of Persia, who had overthrown Babylon, decided to help them rebuild the temple back in Jerusalem. He organized people from all over the land to give livestock and supplies to the Israelites. He even returned all of the gold and silver that the Babylonians had stolen from the temple. 50,000 Israelites returned to Jerusalem and rebuilt the altar of the temple, then laid the foundation for the building itself. Before the temple was even finished, the Israelites began to offer sacrifices and worship God in it once again. But other countries surrounding Jerusalem began to worry about the Israelites regaining power. So they sabotaged the rebuilding project, and it came to a standstill for 16 years. But God used 2 men, Haggai and Zechariah, to encourage the Israelites to resume building the temple and not to be afraid of their enemies. So they continued building, strengthened by the prophet's words. The opposition continued, this time from a man named Tattenai, the governor of a nearby region. He wanted to stop the Israelites from building and worked to convince the Persian king, Darius, to stop the Israelites. Not only did King Darius not stop the rebuilding project, he threatened Tattenai and anyone else who would try to stop the temple from being rebuilt that he would kill them. Then he made Tattenai give funding, animals, and supplies to the Israelites. So the work continued, and almost 70 years after it had been destroyed, the Israelites finished rebuilding the temple. They dedicated it by sacrificing hundreds of animals to God and returning the priests back to their positions of leadership in the temple. God was once again worshiped in Jerusalem.
This Old Testament story is amazing. It is totally ridiculous. It makes no sense how God makes the way. If you remember a while back when we were talking about Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they were uncompromising in their faith, and God blessed what they did in their work and put them in favor with King Nebuchadnezzar. And you almost get the idea that when you follow God and you're faithful, God will bless you and he will make your relationships with the people of power good so that that will influence them. Total fail. Because what actually happens is Nebuchadnezzar gets wiped out by the Persians. And then I want to move a little bit ahead in the story to show how mysterious this is. In Ezra 5, This is what happens. Tattenai goes up against the people of Israel. He's the governor of the area, which means he's sort of a sub-leader under the Persian king. No longer the Persian king that sent them. He's long since passed away. And this is what he says. He said, this is a copy of the letter that Tattenai, the governor, and the other officials of the province west of the Euphrates River sent to King Darius. To King Darius, greetings. The king should know that we went to the construction site of the temple of the great God in the province of Judah. It is being rebuilt with specially prepared stones, and timber is being laid in its walls. The work is going forward with great energy and success. This is after having been stalled for 16 years. And then he says, we asked the leaders, who gave you permission to rebuild this temple and restore this structure? And we demanded their names so that we could tell you who the leaders are. And this was their answer. And then this is the aha moment of Ezra 5. Tattenai tells Darius in the letter exactly what the people of Israel said. Have you heard of spin? Do you know how sometimes people tell the story from their own perspective to try to get you to kind of agree with? No. Tattenai, his thinking is, they made this up. There's no way this really happened. Because, of course, the people of Israel say that the Cyrus gave them permission to come and provided for them. Well, that couldn't possibly be true. And so they're writing Darius, and they know Darius is going to give them permission to shut this down. He didn't give his permission to do this. And instead, Darius goes back into the records because Cyrus wrote it down, and we're very clearly told that at the beginning of Ezra. And he comes back and he says, now, let me just interrupt the flow here to help make sense of this. Have you ever had a leadership group tell you that something is going to cost so much money? And then they come back to you and say, So Cyrus, at the beginning, sends 50,000 of the Jews back to Jerusalem to reestablish the temple. And he gives them buku resources to make it happen. He encourages, and all the people of the land respond to the encouragement. Why? I have no idea. And they get all these resources, and they start. And they stop. They were already given their budget. Well, you know, even though some of that budget was gold and silver, most of that came in the form of resources. And you know what happens to resources when they sit around for 16 years? King Darius doesn't say, look, we gave this ragtag group their chance. He says, no, now, Titius, you must provide for everything they need to rebuild the temple. Cyrus, Darius, Titius, none of them were believers in Yahweh. None of them were Jews. None of them were followers of God. And yet somehow God moved in their hearts to provide for the people of Israel so that God's promise that he would restore this exiled, disobedient people to a relationship with him would indeed come about. It's an amazing story. And the fact that Cyrus, king of Persia, not only made this decree, but he did it persuasively, and he did it in writing. It's as though that God knew already that there would be some bumps in the road as they tried to pursue what God had called them to do. There would be some city officials saying, maybe you need to do a little more to get something done. I, in my naivete of faith, sometimes believe that when God calls me to do something, he will provide the way, and the way will be smooth and joyous. Last year, when I wasn't getting information back from Houston, even though I believe that's what God had called me to do, I decided to help God out and find a way to go to Haiti. But luckily, God persisted in making that path clear. He forced me to make this journey trusting him to provide an opportunity, which he did in spades. You see, what God really wants in our relationship with him is not simply obedience, but trust. He wants us to recognize his love for us. He wants us to recognize his commitment to us. He wants us to recognize that God is a God who seeks to dwell with his people. And so he wants us to live our lives in confident relationship. I was telling Marilyn once in a text message, I responded from Houston, and I texted, "Hey, I got to go diving today." And of course, she was like, "What? How do you dive in Rosenberg?" Well, I clarified, it was dumpster diving. They had these three huge dumpsters that had been overloaded such that the trucks could not take them away. And so the city sued Friends of North Rosenberg, the Attack Poverty organization I was working with, and only to find out that Friends of North Rosenberg had nothing to do with those particular bins and weren't responsible for them. And then the government did what the government sometimes does with Christian organizations. They came back very much like they do here in Tucson, and they said, "Can you help us out?" And so for a year, those dumpsters have been sitting there because, believe me, it is a hot and thankless job to take garbage out of one dumpster and put it in the dumpster next to it in June in Texas. We had a ball. Let me tell you, the sounds coming out of that dumpster to prove we were masculine, hurrah, And the stuff we found a prom dress in its bag. We found candles and pearls. And I offered the lady with us an opportunity to take that home to have a nice romantic dinner at home, but she didn't take it. We just made the service fun because we knew we were there with a purpose. The work was hard. The work was hot. The work was dangerous. But we knew the reason we were there was not about the work, but was about honoring God and serving in his name. And it made the work, it made the attitude with which we did the work to make the work more pleasant. That's one of the things I learned in sabbatical, is that we can trust that God's word holds a miracle. When God calls his people to a task, he will provide a way. It's not easy. It's not without wrinkles. It's not without requiring faith and persistence and trust. But God provides a way for us to do those things that he calls us to do. God doesn't call the equipped. He equips the called. And when we, in our persistent service, trust in God's power to provide through Cyrus, through Darius, through the enemy, the governor. And then last night, I was at Kingdom Impact Tucson worshiping with them, with Pastor John Bacon, and he put up a slide from Samuel, and it was an amazing slide because it said this. It's from 2 Samuel 7:21. It said this: "For your word's sake and according to your own heart, you have done all these great things." Because God is faithful to his word, because God acts in alignment with his own character and heart, he has done these things. But listen to how the verse, 2 Samuel 7:21, ends. To make your servant know them. God acts according to his word. God acts according to his heart and character so that we can know his word and his heart and put our trust in them. God doesn't just want us to be blindly obedient. He wants us to remember the goodness of who he is and the privilege that is ours to serve him and honor in him. Trust, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. One last thought about this word that comes to Haggai to reignite the work on the temple after it's been stalled. See, the people have been working on their own homes and their own businesses while the temple just was put on hold for 16 years. And here's an interesting thing about that story. They were successful. Their homes were beautiful. Their businesses were thriving, and they were miserable. One of the guys I met in Richmond owned his own company and was just burned out. And when the hurricane hit last August, he just decided to put his company on pause and take a year and just go out and help people. And he was skilled, and it was wonderful to work next to him. But he just said, you know, I need more purpose and meaning in my life. And God had blessed him with enough resources that he literally put his company on hold so that he could go out and make a difference in people's lives. I want you to understand that Desert Hope, walking with Jesus so that together we're making a difference, is about demonstrating in tangible ways the character of the God we serve, his love, his provision, his blessing, so that people can see it in us and through us. It is a joy to be home. God is good. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom, let's say it together, I trust. Thanks be to God.